Fallout is my favourite video game franchise ever. Like, ever. I have thousands of hours across the series, and most of them are in the best game ever made, Fallout New Vegas. Ooh, look at that, another Brit thinks that New Vegas is one of the best games. Look, there's a reason we think so, it's not my fault that it's basically a perfect game. But I'm getting way ahead of myself here. I'm gonna be looking back at the entire franchise, yeah, even those ones. I'm not going to be covering Brotherhood of Steel on the grounds that I don't want to buy a PS2 game that doesn't have Lego or Budokai in the title. I mean, you and I both know why Brotherhood of Steel sucks. Even Fred Zelaney, who was a quest designer on Fallout 3, said, "I don't know if I'll ever feel fully clean again. I so wanted it to be good because it's been so very long since a good Fallout game. Nowadays, I keep the disc around solely to focus all of my hatred and scorn into it, but I try not to actually touch it lest its fundamental badness rub off on me." Jesus Christ. Back to Fallout 1. Tim Cain, who I'm basically convinced is the second coming of Christ, is the original creator and the lead developer on Fallout. The game started off as an idea he tinkered with from time to time. He went on to create the engine and design some mechanics based on GURPS, which is a weird acronym. General Universal Role-Playing System. Surely it would be JURPS then? Oh god, I'm gonna summon the GIF defenders. Tim managed to get a few more of Interplay's staff on board with this project, but not without annoying his bosses. I respect that, Tim. He was given no money, no resources, only time. Which is ironic since the main quest is a race against time. Over the next 3 years, he would build a team of about 30 and they created one of the most influential games in history. Development on Fallout is a real treat to listen to because it's also small. Chris Taylor, another lead developer, wrote the mission statement on Fallout 1. "This is a wasteland. Life is cheap and violence is all there is." And that's just so painfully apt for not only Fallout 1, but all the games that come after it. Finally releasing on October 10th, 1997, a whole 3 years before I was even born, Fallout, a post-nuclear role-playing game, burst onto the scene. Going back to that whole GURPS thing, GURPS is a tabletop roleplay system designed by Steve Jackson Games. It's kind of like Dungeons & Dragons, but much more general. It allows for any kind of setting. Steve Jackson Games and Interplay were happily working together as of June of 1996. Steve Jackson Games even released an update on the development. 1 month later, Interplay sent over some development updates, namely the opening cinematic, and it came back quote-unquote unapproved. So that's it then, Steve Jackson Games pulled out. Well, not exactly. In researching this video, I found that the GURPS wiki entry on Fallout and the legal troubles around it, the wiki seems to frame it as if Steve Jackson Games were the one apprehensive to publish such a violent game. But that doesn't seem to be the whole truth. In a PC Gamer 1998 article, Michael Wolf wrote a correction on a mistake that he made in a previous article, where he claimed, "Originally using the GURPS license from Steve Jackson Games, the entire system had to be reworked from the ground." My phone went off, fuck. Originally using the GURPS license from Steve Jackson Games, their entire system had to be reworked from the ground up when Jackson withdrew from the deal. Later, Jackson himself wrote a letter to Wolf stating that he didn't drop the license, Interplay did. According to Jackson, the media contacted him asking why the license had been dropped. He had no idea until Interplay had already made the decision. However, in the same article, Fergus... Fergus Urquhart claims that Jackson had some troubles with Fallout. He didn't like the violence in the introduction. And apparently, their contract stated that Jackson had control over the environment in which the license is used, which is pretty vague, as Wolf says. Jackson apparently said that if Interplay went ahead with Fallout as it is, then he would take action. Scott Campbell, another developer, has a similar story. In his Origins of Fallout, No Mutant Outpost, he claimed that Steve Jackson Games was sent the introduction cinematic and then said unapproved. Scott seems a little upset with this. However, dropping GURPS led to the special system, which is one of the most iconic mechanics in the game. Fuck, I forgot I was supposed to be talking about a video game and not some internal politics of a now defunct video game company from 26 years ago. In preparation for this video, I replayed Fallout, just to keep it fresh in my mind. I decided to stream it to my friends on Discord and I asked for their input during my playthrough. On first opening the game, they had this to say. "That's like the guy from Fallout, I think. I think Cloud Strife is in there. I've seen him in Smash. Thanks, guys!" Later, they praised the aesthetic and asked me about the timeline of the franchise. One of my friends brought up one of their grievances with Fallout 76. We discussed how the tone of 1 and 76 were so drastically different, despite 1 taking place after 76. When watching the opening cinematic, their reactions to the soldier shooting the man in the streets were obviously negative. This made me think about the juxtaposition of the situation. The soldier's so happy to wave to the camera like he thinks he's invincible and this is all a joke. We'll find out later that the US of this world thinks they are invincible. Phew. Fallout takes place in an AU of the real world. Yeah, they were doing AUs far before your underswaps and reverse fools. Most people like to credit the divergence from our timeline being that the transistor was never invented in Fallout. Cool theory, still wrong. Chris Avalon, game designer in Fallout 2, says that Fallout takes place in a future Earth in an alternate timeline. I will not be including any information on how or when it diverged, and it will remain one of the mysteries of the setting. Ultimately, Fallout takes place of an alternate history. A future inspired by the 1950s idea of the world of tomorrow. You know, that whole Jetson vibe, sleek cars, household robots, outrageous inflation problem. And I mean, the world used to look like this, but then it exploded. You see, after World War II, they began to use atomic energy for more than just weaponry. They used it as a power source. Technology began to boom. But then their rampant consumerism began to lead to shortages. The world scrambled for resources. The superpowers of America and China began fighting for any drop of oil that they could. Eventually, it all came to a head. Nobody knows who started the Great War, but everyone lost. Within 2 hours, the world was razed by nuclear fire. Some Americans managed to retreat to underground bunkers known as vaults. One vault, Vault 13, is where you were born. 84 years after the Great War, the watership of the vault begins to fail. The overseer of the vault decides to send one of his people out to find another watership in Vault 15. By pure bad luck, you pull the short straw and you're sent out into the wasteland. Next comes character creation! Fuck me, that's a lot of text! Okay, let's break it down. Name is your name, and age is your age.
Mono means one. And rail means rail.
Your age dictates nothing in the game at all. You can also choose your gender here. Gender doesn't change much. Some NPCs will have a bit of dialogue change or something. You should then start with the special stats over. Yeah. Strength is useful for lifting stuff and for hitting things. It's really helpful since weapons have strength requirements, and yeah, while you can equip them, your efficiency is massively reduced. This came back to bite me in the ass in my recent playthrough. Perception is good for ranged weapons and not much else. I'd recommend Perception 5 just for the awareness perk. See, by default, the game doesn't tell you how much HP anything has. Endurance is for HP, really. I wouldn't put more than 4 in it. Charisma is good for bartering. Trust me, you won't need it. Dump stat for sure. Intelligence is for but anyone playing Fallout 1 is a nerd, so you should put points into it. It's helpful for so much, and I say you should pump it to at least an A. Agility is super important. In these classic games, your action points determine what you can do in a turn, and attacks require multiple action points, so again, I'd put this to an A. Luck is always king in Fallout. Criticals, random encounters, gambling. It's so useful, and you should definitely have it as an 8. Next up are traits. Traits are so fucking cool. They're unique perks that come with a downside. I'd only really recommend Finesse, which raises critical chance for a lower non-critical damage. Fast Shot, which allows weapons to use one less action point in exchange for no longer being able to target body parts, and Gifted for any character. What does Gifted do? It increases every special stat by 1. Fuck the downsides, it's absolutely worth it. That build I recommended before, you've got 9s in 3 stats. By the end of the game, there will be 10. It's almost too good, honestly. In return, you'd lose 5 skill points every time you level up, and your skills lose 10% at the start, but it's fine. I'll only be using a handful of them anyway. Bloody Mess is super fun as well, but it gets a little stale in my opinion. Changes the ending though, which is pretty cool. Over on your right are the skills, and you can tag 3 of them. Tagging skills means that they'll increase twice as fast. These ones are for combat, these are active, and these are passive. I won't break all of them down, it's pretty self-explanatory. I recommend tagging speech, lockpick, and whatever combat style you want to go for. As for me, I let my friends decide my builds, given the... Bills? Me? I let my friends decide my build, given the advice that I just told you. Me. She's
21.
And she's gifted and she's lucky, but she was jinxed, so bad things always seem to happen around her. Ian critically missed, lost 10 hit points, knocked down, and his weapon exploded, and he lost his next turn. Oh, fucking spectacular! It's like Milo Murphy's pissing lore out here! Let's talk about combat real quick. Fallout works on a turn-based battle system. You know, like Pokemon, but more murder. Turn order, or sequence in-game, is determined by a lot of things, but mostly perception. When you approach an enemy, the game will enter into combat mode. Every action here results in action points being used. There are some perks that lower your cost of actions, like opening your inventory or moving further. You can end your turn early, which turns your remaining AP into armor class, which is basically your dodge chance. That's about the gist of it. I haven't mentioned my favorite feature of the combat, which is even in the modern games now. That's the Vault-Tec assisted targeting system. Please note that it wasn't called that until Fallout 3, but it's called target shot here, but that's nowhere near as cool. You can target a specific body part. Ever wanted to shoot a rat in the groin? No? Too bad, you can. Aiming for the eyes does the most damage, but it has a lower chance to hit. Okay, that's mostly it for combat, but that speech skill wasn't just for flavor. Throughout the game, you'll find yourself in a ton of different situations, and sometimes combat isn't the best choice. Not just for morality's sake, but for your own sake. This game is brutally hard if you're underprepared. You should find solutions to issues without violence, and there usually always is one. Another thing I'd recommend to new players is to save often, since one firefight might end in your death, and the game isn't exactly the most stable on newer hardware. Crashes can really screw you over. You have 10 save slots, you should be using all of them, just in case. Oh, and be polite, the wasteland is really dangerous, and you're more likely to find someone that would sell you for a Nuka-Cola than a friendly face. Don't give them more reasons to kill you. Why did I write N? Now we're on to the story, and I'm not going to cover the whole game's story, since I want you to go and play it, and if you've already played it, then I want you to play it again! After leaving the cave, hiding Vault 13, you're put on the map menu. If you wanted to, and you were smart enough, you could go straight to the final areas and beat the game in about 15 minutes. But you don't know where that is yet, but you do know where you can find another water chip. Maybe. Vault 15 is to the east, so let's head over there. Along the way, we find another area, and it can't hurt to go in. Welcome to Shady Sands! Approaching the gate will cause the guard, Seth, to tell you to put your gun away. If you heed his warning, you can head inside and start talking to people and exploring the town. If you don't put your gun away, he'll attack you, so please put your gun away. There's a few interesting people to talk to. Katrina on the left will explain some basic gameplay mechanics, healing, bartering, and so on. She'll also tell you to visit Ian in the building over to the right. By talking to her, you'll gain some experience, showing that murder isn't the only way to get experience in this game. Opposite from her, Seth will tell you about a rampant red scorpion issue that the town is having. He'll point you to Aradesh, who is the leader of Shady Sands, so let's go and talk to him.
Greetings. Your business in Shady Sands might be...
Oh my god! What's wrong with your face?
This is one of the 21 talking heads in Fallout. They all look this horrifying, some more so. Aradesh once again tells us that they're being terrorized by rad scorpions. We can offer to help and go back to Seth to get him to take us to the rad scorpion caves. On the way, you can go talk to that Ian guy. He'll mark some locations on your map, like Junktown and the Hub. And he'll also join your party for 100 caps or a really easy speech check. Like, I've never failed this speech check. I even have to look it up just to see if you could fail it. Seth will take you over to the Rad Scorpion Caves if you want. Kill the scorps, grab a tail for later. When you're done, head back to Shady Sands and talk to Razlo to turn one of the tails into an antidote that you can use in the guy in the back for some extra XP. Right, well that was fun, it didn't help us find a water chip, so let's head over to... This is the first dungeon of the game. By heading inside, you'll see that the vault is entirely abandoned, as Katrina said. The walls are brown, rusted, and it likely smells of rat feces. Fucking rats! You get to the elevator and it's broken. You need a rope to get down. How do you get a rope? I'm not a guide, go find it yourself. You get to a second elevator where you need to use another rope. Luckily, there's another rope on this level along with some armor and a rifle, which I'd love to use, but strength 4! Down you go to the final level, head over to the overseer's office, and of course, it's blocked. Well, now you've got no leads, but you have some other areas to check out. We'll head over to Junktown next, since it's closer. On our way over, I'm going to talk about random encounters. There's a ton of encounters that are unique to specific areas, such as the mountains, desert, coast, and city. Encounters are determined by luck, outdoorsman skill, ranger perks, and just general RNG. These encounters can easily end your run, so save before you leave locations. Welcome to Junktown. Junktown is a town made of junk.
Right.
Walking in, you'll be told to put your gun away again. The gun law in this town is they can only be used in self-defense. And I exercise that right against Doc Morbid. I'm not paying 10 caps for what my menu can tell me. By the way, I headed into a basement, killed the doctor and this short king. I started looting because, you know, fuck it, why not? And then I set off a trap and I exploded. God, I love this game. Reloading an old save, I said fuck that to Doc Morbid and headed towards the store. I approached the storekeep, Killian, and...
Can I help you?
Oh my. Maybe I can help you. Killian is a shopkeeper of Junktown. His inventory will contain some upgrades for you, but nothing really worth buying yet. Just unload some of the junk you have on him for some caps and stim packs. Alright, let's go explore the town. Oh hey, this NPC is going in. I wonder if it's got like a shopping AI or...
Gizmo sends his regards.
Killian, no! Yeah, let's jump his ass!
Fight back, nigga! Fight back, nigga!
After saving Killian...
Listen, thanks for saving my life.
He says that he knows who ordered the attack. Yeah, no shit, idiot! I know who ordered the attack! The moron said Gizmo sends his regards in red text! Anyway, he tells us that we'd be perfect to solve his little Gizmo problem. He and his gods know that Gizmo is bad news, but they don't have any proof. We can get this proof by either bugging his office or getting a confession. So let's go to the casino. On the way, we see someone running away from a dog.
Oh!
We talk to the man, and he tells us that the dog has been hanging around here since its owner died. His owner was a man that wore black leather and carried a shotgun. Sounds familiar, eh? Yeah, so a reference to Mad Max, which was a major inspiration for Fallout 1. If we wear the leather jacket or give the dog an iguana on a stick, then he'll follow us around, becoming our second companion. We also find out that his name is Dogmeat, which is a reference to a boy and his dog. Another inspiration. Dogmeat is kind of a support unit in this game. He doesn't do loads of damage, but he attacks 2-3 times per round, and he's got a pretty decent chance of knocking down enemies. Short aside here, Fallout 1 has casinos with a few different games, but the one that you should keep an eye on is roulette. Winning in roulette with high luck stat is super easy, and you end up winning more than you lose. So if you hold down 1 and 4, then you just get unlimited money. So first, we rinse Gizmo's casino, and then we go and get his stupid confession. On our way out, we see a bar and try to go in. It's locked, which makes sense because it's a morning, so we wait until night to go inside. One of the patrons is wearing a gas mask and a trench coat. That's cool, it reminds me of the NCR Rangers, so I talk to him and he gives me his intense lore. And he gives me some tips on surviving in the desert. We can ask for his help and he'll join us. Tycho is such a fucking badass. He's a former NCR Ranger, he's had multiple injuries before and he doesn't react too much to new ones. His combat dialogue implies that he's lost teeth, parts of his ear, he's broken legs and shattered ribs. He even taunts enemies that they should aim for his head because anything else will only slow him down. In-game, he's the best companion. He's skilled with unarmed weapons, spears, small pistols, rifles, and shotguns. He has the most hit points out of all of the companion and the second best armor resist. His best weapons are the sniper rifle and the limited edition BB gun. I recommend the latter. Getting back on track, we head over to Killian and we find out that his shop is locked, so we spend the night in a local hotel. When we wake up, we get told that Cynthia is being held hostage. We can either ignore this or offer to help. When we get into the room, you could either shoot him or try and hear him out. We're diplomatic, and we're not too ruined by the wastelands yet, so we decide to talk to him. With a high enough speech skill, you can tell him to leave, and he does. Right, let's go and deliver this evidence to Killian. He says that we could go with him to arrest Killian... Fuck, why did I say Killian in the script? That's so stupid. He says that we should go with him to arrest Gizmo, and I fought against this. I'm really busy, but it would be really funny to see the fat fucker try and move more than 3 feet. And Tycho wanted to kill the guy, so we joined them. Done. Well, that felt good to help out, but it didn't really help us get any water, so we should head over to the hub. But first, I want to talk about special encounters. There are also 6 special encounters. I found 5 of these in my playthrough. Well, both of them. See, I played with my friends, but I completely forgot to record it, and I got hyperfixated on playing the game that I accidentally beat it, so I had to play it again just to get the footage for this. You can find a group of Brahmin that say, Moo! Moo, I say! That's it. That's all they do. That's all they do. A dead peasant in a gigantic footprint. This thing must have been ginormous, bigger than Liberty Prime even. You can find a stealth boy in the remains, which is probably how the poor guy died. Stealth boys make you invisible, for those that didn't get that joke. Bob's a crazy old man trying to sell you these cars. He has a BB gun in the back, which is marginally better than throwing rocks. He also has the limited edition variant, which is much, much better. I always give it to Tycho so he can shoot twice per turn. This one's a Doctor Who reference. I always pog a little when I see it. It drops a motion sensor, which is useless. Just open your eyes. It's good to sell, though. So my game kept crashing when I got a special encounter near the end game. I think it was this one. Anyway, it's a crash truck, which isn't awfully impressive in our world, but when your economy works on bottle caps, in the money, we're in the money. Depending on your luck stat, you can find over 10,000 bottle caps here, and that doubles if you take the Fortune Finder perk. So yeah, luck is king. Good rewards for taking luck, but the next encounter makes it worth going max luck in every single run. A crashed flying saucer with two alien skeletons in the front of it. Inspecting the ships will show property of Area 51, return if found. But that's not all. One of their bodies will have a fuzzy painting of Elvis, and the other will have the alien blaster. This is the best weapon in Fallout 1, and it's not close. Welcome to the Hub. The Hub is the biggest trading center in California, and it's the reason that the series uses caps. Bottle caps are used as a currency in the West. Each bottle cap is backed by a bottle of water, with water so rare in a fucking desert, it becomes a premium. Water traders in the Hub will trade one bottle cap for one bottle of water. And, you know, since it's so much easier to carry around 1,000 bottle caps than 1,000 bottle of waters, it makes sense. Yeah, great. Thanks, Bethesda. There's a load of quests to do here, and even more shopping to be done. In regards to our whole water situation, and we hear that there's water merchants. We head over to them and talk to them about a water chip, which they don't have. But they note that vaults and necropolis would have them. Necropolis? Why would they need one? She assumes that the local inhabitants must have a reliable source of purified water, as they don't seem interested in trading water with them. Well, 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 we found a lead. And since we only know where two vaults are, we might as well head to Necropolis. Necropolis. Short side note, you can actually pay to have water shipped over to your vault. This will increase the time before your vaults run out of water by 100 days. The merchant does warn you that this might bring more attention to your vault. In the unpatched version, this would take 100 days off of the evasion timer. So, you know, if you're playing on Steam, go for it. You've got nothing to lose. You approach a dark and broken city. Little life can be seen. A stench of death surrounds the area. How pleasant. There are a small group of zombified ghouls.
Son of a bitch. What are you talking about now?
Funny little green ghouls.
But that doesn't get me closer to a water chip, so I decide to do a flushed away reference and get into the sewers.
Another issue. What are you two doing in the sewer?
We always go in the sewer.
After a bit of trudging through the sewers, we find ourselves in front of some sentient, peaceful ghouls. Their leader tells us about Set, the leader of Necropolis. This is not water-related, so I do not care. He eventually tells us that there's a place underground that has a computer that purifies water. Sounds promising, thanks.
You aren't thinking of taking the water chip from us, are you? If you take the water chip from us, then we will all die.
Fine. So we go and find the parts for the pump, return to the leader, then go back to the surface and see a huge green thing. We decide to ignore it and just head over to the water pump.
Hello, pretty lady. You look real nice.
This is Harry. Harry is an idiot. We'll talk about why later. But for now, we'll use our feminine wiles to charm our way out going to see Lou, but we'll catch up with Lou in a bit. Install the parts into the pump and boom, it's fixed. Now we can finally go and get the water chip. On the way down, we get interrupted by a ghoul prisoner. We're not law-abiding, so we let him out. We head down to Vault 12. We ignore the glowing ones because they're not actively hostile. And we go to the one active computer and finally get our hands on a water chip. Alright, main quest is almost done. Let's head back to... Vault 13 is an odd place in Fallout 1. It's one of the few clean areas left, and it kind of puts you on edge being there. Even the music in the background is off-putting. I think it's because the player character has been out in the wasteland for so long. Even though you're home, you're still on edge. Every noise is a false threat. The clacking of keyboards, the whirring and moving of machinery, pipes carrying steam and water, it all keeps you alert. You've had to be on your guard in the wasteland, and you can't just turn that off. As we make our way down, noises like whispers and intercom interference plays out. Nobody rushes to greet you or anything. Are they scared of you? Even Ian states,
heard about these places before, never been in one. Seems nice and clean, a little too clean for my taste.
Vaults aren't meant for wastelanders, it's all just another danger to them. Eventually, you return to the Overseer. The chip is installed correctly, and everything okay, and the vault is saved. The Overseer requests a report of what you've seen on the surface, and it terrifies him.
I don't like your reports. What was in the reports, that is. In fact, they scared the heck out of me. It's those mutants.
He comes to the conclusion that something is making the mutants, so he sends us out again with two objectives. Destroy the lab, kill the leader. We asked if he has any leads on this, and he seems to think it's coming from the west. Let's do this. After walking west for a couple of days, we reach a military base with those mutants patrolling outside. I manage to bluff to the mutants that I'm
on a diplomatic mission to Alderaan,
and I let myself in. I walked around for a bit, girl-bossing and gaslighting past all the guards and making my way to this terminal where I accidentally activated all of the yellow barriers. I decided that I would probably be better off speaking to the lieutenant.
Oh, this is excellent. You know, I actually doubted my officers when they said they'd captured a prime normal.
We try and talk our way out of fighting him, and it just doesn't work. He keeps torturing me until I tell him where the vault is, but I'll never rat them out.
Why do you have so much power?
Jesus Christ, fuck those guys, actually. They sent me out here. They can deal with the consequences. We're shown a cutscene where I'll just let you watch it.
It is done. Vault 13 belongs to the Unity and the Master. Your knowledge of the vault defenses saved many mutant lives during the attack. You personally made the final kill when you took the life of the Overseer. You will certainly become one of the finest soldiers for the Unity, and your skills will see you rewarded often in the future. You are happy. But there remains the tiniest doubt of what could have been.
Jesus, that's a bad ending to Fallout. We're turned into a super mutant and we destroy our vault. The narrator is right, so let's see what could have been. By loading an old save, we're back outside the military base. We're way too weak and we need to be stronger if we want to destroy those things. So let's go back to the hub to find some stronger gear. We find a man called Jake and he says that the gunrunners have a better selection of guns, so let's head south at some point. On our way out, I ran into a building to do some looting, and I get instantly attacked. One skirmish later, I find a man in a locked room. I'm nice, so I let him out. He explains that he's part of the Brotherhood of Steel and he marks it on our map. Now, if there's anything that I know about the Brotherhood, it's that they have a lot of firepower and fantastic armor. So let's go get some. As I fiddle around in my inventory, I want to talk about the music used here. It's called Metallic Monks, and you feel that. air raid sirens and scraping metal is used throughout this track. It almost sounds like a chant, but it's wrong somehow. I think this is one of the best tracks in the entire series because it invokes such a strong sense of dread. It's eerie and off-putting. If you listen long enough, you'll begin to hear Morse code and militant drum snares. It's so perfect for Fallout 1, where you're exploring and trying to make sense of not only this new world, but the world that came before it. These echoes of the old world can be heard a lot in the soundtrack. Mark Morgan is a goddamn genius. One inventory sorting later, and we find ourselves speaking to Initiate Cabot.
Hello, and welcome to the Brotherhood of Steel. May I ask your business here?
I'd like to join.
I talked to the High Elder, and he said that not just anyone can join. He said you have to complete a quest first.
Sure, why not? All I do is get things for other people.
You have to go to the ruins of the Ancient Order, that's south of here. You've got to go inside and bring back something that proves that you were there.
Okie doke, see you in a...
I can't believe they're sending her in there.
Okay. Well, this is a big hole. You have received a large dose of radiation. Grand. Pop some pills and throw a rope down to get inside. This place is massive and it's great for loot, but I'm really not interested in it. I am interested in that dead Brotherhood member over there. Grab the holodisc and get the fuck out.
Hey, you're back.
I sure am. Here's the thing. We get access and gain some experience for becoming an initiate. We can get ourselves a few things here, and we can let the Brotherhood know about the military base for some extra support and some more experience. You can also increase your special here by speaking to Dr. Laurie.
Excuse me?
That's better. Now we need some better guns, so let's head south to the... The Boneyard is interesting, but not awfully important, so I'll skip over the majority of it. You can find Katja here, who is the last companion and probably the worst. Don't get me wrong, all of the Fallout 1 companions are pretty nothing characters, but at least Ian and Tycho are good in combat, and Dogmeat is just such a good boy. Katja runs up to enemies and gets herself killed. She sucks, but she has green hair and pronouns, so what do you expect? She does mark the cathedral on the map, so she's not all useless. While we're here, we deal a bit with the gunrunners and then head back to the military base. And we're back here again. Round two, Lou. Oh, my dog's dead. Oh, Kutcher's dead. Oh, me and Ian are dead. Okay, different approach then. We kill everything in our way and we head down the elevators. As I make my way through, I'm going to talk about Lou's plan. He wants to capture Prime Normals. What does that mean? Well, Prime Normals are humans that are untouched by radiation. And considering there's been an entire fucking nuclear apocalypse, everyone on the surface is a radiator. Everyone on the surface is irradiated, so our vault, untouched by radiation, would be Prime Normals. Remember when we did the bad ending and we got turned into a super mutant? Well, the process of turning humans into mutants involves dipping them into a vat of FEV. The FEV is the Forced Evolutionary Virus. It was originally developed to combat the new plague before the war, but that's not awfully important. Radiation ruins DNA, so when radiated humans are exposed to FEV, they transform, but there are side effects. Intelligence is lowered by about 30%, and you can't build a society out of idiots. Well, some people can. However, this isn't the case with pure humans like us. Okay, we've made it to the control room. Kill these cultists or don't, I'm not a cop. We can rig this whole place to blow, and we need to get out of here. Alright, one down, one to go. Let's go deal with the cathedral. This place gives me the creeps. The background music here, named Acolytes of the New God, is perfect for this area. It almost sounds like rattlesnakes are following you. And you feel that unease as you look around. You can almost imagine all of the people here are just watching you, waiting to strike. You can talk to a lot of people here, but I'm done talking. I steal a badge from Laura and let myself into the tower. I make my way to the top, sneaking past Nightkin and other acolytes. At the top, I meet Morbius. No, fuck, Morpheus. No, not that one! Morpheus is a leader of the Children of the Cathedral.
I don't remember inviting anyone to my room, and yet I have a visitor. Why?
We convince him that we have information for his master and he'll take us to him.
So what shall it be? Do you join the Unity, or do you die here?
Join.
Die.
Join.
Die.
The The Master is an abomination of science. Formerly a man known as Richard Gray, he was exposed to FEV for way, way too long. He's been driven to madness.
I am no villain.
You have no idea what I or...
the Unity.
...is about.
We have a high speech skill, and we know that his mutants are sterile, so maybe we can talk him down.
You think you can destroy me?
Destroy
me?
I failed the speech check. Instead of reloading a save, I decide to fight. The Master's a tough fight, but it's not impossible. Oh, bye, dogmate. Bye, catcher. Tycho takes a shot and... the Master is dead and we have 240 seconds to get out of here.
I better get out of here while I still can!
We fight and run through the vault and make our way up to the cathedral. I don't have time to kill you all myself, but I don't need to.
The death of the Master was the first major step towards ending his mad dream of conquest and enforced peace. But it is the destruction of the vats that neutralizes the mutant threat. Without the ability to create more mutants and enforce their harsh brand of justice, the mutant armies flee to the east, beyond the No Man's Land.
At this point, the game will explain what happened thanks to you. There are multiple endings for every location. This is my favorite bit of Fallout 1, 2, and New Vegas. You get this sense that this world has existed before you, and it will exist after you. My friend Yo-Yo agrees and says, "You have a real tangible effect on the world around you, and not in some super protagonistic way. You're really just kind of some guy that helps or stops larger powers, and they're the ones that create the change that you can see." With all these player actions over, there's just one question left.
What happened to you?
You find yourself outside of Vault 13 again, with one last conversation with the Overseer.
You've done it. That's wonderful, amazing. I'm so proud of what you've accomplished, what you've endured. There's no way that people of the Vault can ever thank you enough for what you've done. You've saved all our lives. Who knows? Maybe even save the human race. Imps. That makes the rest of this even harder. Everyone will want to talk to you. Every youngster will look up to you and want to emulate you. And then what? They'll want to leave. What happens to the Vault if we lose the best of a generation? What if we are the only safe place in the world? You just gave us back all these lives. I can't take the chance of losing them. I've made a lot of tough decisions since I took this position, but none of them harder than this one. You saved us, but you'll kill us. I'm sorry. You're a hero. And you have to leave.
Now, if your calm is low enough, or you're taking the bloody mess trait, you will shoot the Overseer. Regardless, this is the end. This song, maybe, by the Ink Spots, I think that it's supposed to be from the perspective of you to Vault 13. Ultimately, it doesn't matter now. You're gone, and maybe it doesn't matter.
You'll think of me when you are all alone.
This game is old, like older than me, older than like SpongeBob. When this game came out, The Simpsons was still in its golden age. What I'm saying is that it's dated, obviously, but it has so much charm. The graphics are a product of their time, but that kind of helps it. With the limited color palette, it really helps Fallout find its look. Remember those talking heads? Yeah, they were made out of clay. Namco MG Community Magazine says, "Using a ferrous base arm and the Vertisketch software, the team digested the head. No, it doesn't. The team digitized the head and used lightwave modeling software to do necessary geometric corrections. Texture maps were created and photoshopped and laid into the modeled head. Finally, the art team had begun working on the animation. God, it's just so cool, and it's only for a handful of NPCs. It took about 8 weeks per head. Onto the audio. The effects are so iconic. They're even being used in the modern games. The begin VAT sound effect in the modern games is the enter combat effect in 1 and 2. The level up chime is used for completing challenges. I've gushed about the soundtrack before, but you really should listen to some of them. And I bet you already have, because they get reused in New Vegas. Fallout 1's entire aesthetic is dread.
What we really need to do is create a powerful sense of dread.
This is the wasteland. Life is cheap and violence is all there is. And while, yeah, that's true, it also means that everything else is not. There's no comfort, no peace, and no calm in the wasteland. Well, that was before you turned up anyway. I didn't really like it. To start, the controls were weird, the game looked dated, there was no lobotomy marker to follow, and there was no direction. That's because I was an idiot. I didn't read or listen. This one NPC said, holster your weapons, and I thought I did, so I walked into town and I got shot, critically hitting me and killing me instantly. I uninstalled the game, went about my day, and forgot about it for months. Then I remember watching this video. It was some lore video. I remember them talking about FEV and the Mariposa military base. It held so much important lore that I didn't want to listen to someone tell me about it. I wanted to experience it myself. So I booted up Fallout, deleted my old save, and tried again. I googled Fallout 1 best build, and I used those special points and I closed a tab. I'd go explore this world for myself, and I fell in love. I listened to the opening, and I noticed things that I never did before. I played it multiple times with different characters. I've had my friends play it. I even gifted it to a streamer just so they would have the opportunity to play it. We're friends now, it's yo-yo, so you can't call me a weirdo for it. Alright, let's fucking rank them, because that's always fun. I see people do this on Twitter all the time. It's going to fucking S tier. Of course it's going in S tier. It's so great. If you've never played it, I'd highly recommend it. The best way to play it, in my opinion, is Fallout 2. It's a mod that recreates the first game in the second game's engine. It's functionally the same, like the story's all the same, the presentation's all the same, but it has really amazing features. Like, you can actually control your companions. If you want more of an authentic feel, then you should probably start with the Fallout Fixed mod. One of my friends said, it's not a perfect game, it has nigh untenable bugs, and it needs patching to really function on a modern engine. They're so smart, I don't even know what untenable means. I don't think I'm biased to this choice, I don't have any nostalgia around it. Yeah, if you got this far in the video, thanks a lot for watching it. I didn't write an intro in my script, I just said just blab, like I would just automatically know what to say, but I obviously don't know what to say. So I just want to say thanks for watching the video. If you enjoyed, please let me know in the comments. Like and subscribe, all that bullshit. I'm going to be making a Fallout 2 video at some point, but for now, I just kind of want to see where this is going. So, like, subscribe, I already said that. Thanks for watching. Goodbye.